year is 2021, and Libsyn launches the latest podcast on the Borgcast Galactica feed. In a freak mishap, Borgcast Galactica and its hosts, Peter and Anne-Marie, are blown out of their trajectory to reemerge as Borg Rogers in the 25th century.
Friend, and welcome to Borg Rogers 1.2 with Anne-Marie and Peter.
Hello. A bit of sad news to start with, slightly bizarrely, after like 24 hours after we'd recorded the last podcast. And what should happen but dear Felix Siller should pass away, who played Tweaky, as in was in the Tweaky suit. And as we said in the previous podcast, had various small people roles in the Star Wars films and Spaceballs and even played a penguin in the Batman films. But there we go. He had actually quite a good career when you look at his entry on IMDb. Oh, yes, rather sad, but there we go.
How old was he?
84. Anyway, let's... How do you go from that to Planet of the Slave Girls? I mean, good grief. I mean, that's a gear shift and a half, isn't it?
Yeah.
But that's what we've got to do, because that's the episode we're... Well, episodes... rather confusingly, that we're covering today. I hadn't realised that this was yet another double-length, movie-length thing. It was originally shown in the two parts together as it is on the DVD, so there we are. And it has to be said, the title is somewhat deceptive, is it not?
Yes.
Because there are men enslaved as well. It's not quite the cheese fest that you expect from the title. I mean, it's still a cheese fest, don't get me wrong. But yeah.
Yeah, it's like, you know when you have a fondue fountain, and normally you'd put, like, maybe breadsticks in the fondue fountain or something to cover it with cheese.
I've never had a fondue fountain.
Oh.
How do we get a fondue fountain? I want fondue. Although it really won't do my guts any good, will it?
It won't. It's amazing, but no. This is like somebody decided that what they were going to dip in a fondue fountain was a block of cheese.
Oh, thank crud for that. I thought you were going to say something else then.
Oh, my God. No.
You could have made it worse by going, a knob of cheese.
You never want to do that with me, I'm just telling you, because I'll bite.
Right, yeah, just move swiftly on now, because this is all sort of mental images that are troubling even me.
Yeah. But then with this episode, yeah.
So, you must ready yourselves, my friends. Your moment is at hand. No longer shall you live in a sea of stone, while others reap the benefits of our world's lush glory. No longer shall you work to feed the people of distant planets, while your own sons and daughters go hungry. Soon, you will descend upon the earth like meteors, like fire. Consume them with the flames of your righteous anger.
So you start with Buck and Wilmer in a fighter, and Wilmer is the co-pilot.
We have ordinary credits.
We do.
Without lots of women posing on Buck's name, thankfully.
Yeah. And Wilmer is the co-pilot, which to me doesn't seem right, given that she's got the higher rank.
And you know what turns out that's weird is that she's shooting and Buck is flying. But surely those lasers are fixed. It's not like there's a gunner position here. It's a bit bizarre, really, but there we go.
Yes, it is odd, but never mind. They're coming up to Stargate 4, which I quite like the look of.
Yeah, it's a swish effect, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't like the effect of Buck's head spinning round, though.
No. Yeah, just a tad. You kind of expect it to be that he looks different the other end of it, like Super Ted saying the magic word, which I always used to think was please.
Well, it is, isn't it?
Yeah. Anyway, he's sort of a bit nauseous, but she says that he'll get used to it.
So will we.
Yeah. And then they can see some fighters flying, and then one of them seems to be in distress, under attack from pirates. And Buck's like, you know, we should help. And Wilmer says, yes, we should. So Buck to the rescue.
You know, of squeaky voice teen.
Yeah, it is a bit.
Oh, hi.
And then Then Buck makes a reference to what sounds like fucking Wagnalls, and you told me it wasn't fucking Wagnalls, it was something else.
Thunk and Wagnalls.
Which is what now?
Which sounds like it ought to be a euphemism, you're quite right. I've got my Thunk and Wagnalls in a twist.
Yes.
But actually it's the United States inversion of Collins English Dictionary.
Mm?
So in other words, she's talking about, unless I've got your definition wrong.
Oh.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Fine. Anyway, they shoot the pirate and the squeaky voice teen is okay. But Major Duke Denton,
yeah.
For fuck's sake.
What a guy.
Now, I think I know Major Duke Denton for something.
He's played by David Groh, but nothing in particular came up in my IMDb-ing of him, so.
Okay. But he's all sort of like, it's a testosterone off, basically.
Yes, there's plenty of dick waggling going on here, isn't there?
Yeah. Yes, yes. And it turns out the Buck has declined to join the Earth. Is it Protectorate or Directorate?
Earth Defence Directorate. That's it. Okay. As opposed to the Earth Food Directorate, which we'll get later on.
Yep. Okay. Anyway, he's declined to join, but then there's clearly this sort of testosterone off, which Wilma seems to be quite enjoying. Mm. And so she says that Bucky's going to be heading up a teaching session of the cadets. Because Duke Danton was all like, how dare you interfere with my training mission? And he's like, well, you know, there's something wrong with your training if that's what's going on. And then Wilma's like, no, I gave the go-ahead. Which is true, she did. And she's of equal rank.
Well, no, she outranks him because she's a colonel, he's a major.
Okay, I don't understand those. Fine.
That's the whole thing. And he's sniffy about it. The book later on suggests that might have been the reason why Wilma and he fell out. It's because she went on to outrank him and his testosterone couldn't cope with that concept.
Right.
Mm. Wouldn't surprise me.
No. No. So he's going to go and deliver some training.
Which is bloody awful. Here he is. You know, he's a man in the 25th century, and what's his training? It's all about American football. So then he has to explain his terms. Then he has to explain the terms he's using to explain his terms. It's just, for heaven's sake, man, you should have realised that using American football analogies is just not going to work here.
I mean, I'm glad it doesn't, because it doesn't work for me, because I'm not American. But, like, he had that diagram, so why didn't he just say, this is what you do?
Exactly. Imagine these are your ships. You go up the middle and take out the ship at the back.
You don't need to use all the red-dogging, blingy-blonging, flucky-flucking, whatever the buggery bollocks it is, language, oh, which I've never liked. The red-dogging and sack your quarterback and, I don't know, the 10-4 instead of yes or whatever the fucking fuck any of that is that I don't like.
Yeah.
Sorry. It just annoys me that when people do all that, oh, what is it? 10-4. And you get that in, Battle of the Planets, don't you?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, it's just like yes or no or will do or something. Not numbers, when everybody else knows what the numbers are. So it isn't a code and it doesn't work. Ugh. Reminds me, I'll tell you what I wanted to see the moment I watched this. Was, I think, I can't remember whether it's Duck Soup or Horse Feathers. If Dave Probert is listening to this, he will know and he will be able to say. But there's a Marx Brothers film where they just take the piss out of American football and you've got Groucho Marx just spouting gibberish and as if it's a commandy thing. I love it. It's brilliant. It's amazing. Watch it. Anyway, enough about the Marx Brothers and back to this episode, which is really cheesy. And to be honest, it is really fun. This just, the testosterone off and everything else is bad, but the whole of the rest of the episode, well, honestly, it's really good fun.
Basically, I was slightly losing the will to live until a bit later on, and I will tell you when I suddenly got into this episode and it took off in a big way.
Yeah,
so.
So you can see the pilot, squeaky voice team, his nerves are deteriorating and that's affecting his motor functions.
And they're just in the room with him and they know he's infected with something. But there's no isolation or anything. It's just stupid.
Yeah, and later you find out what the issue is and it didn't matter. But at this point in time, they don't know. Yeah. And there's 25,000 people affected in New Chicago, which Colin pronounces in a really odd way, doesn't he?
Dr. Hugh, you mean? Yes.
Yes. New Chicago or something. I don't know. He says, I mention it simply because no one else in the entire show pronounces it that way. It's just a him pronunciation.
Amusingly, our old vicar, Colin, who he reminds us of, used to do exactly
the same thing.
There were words that he would pronounce that nobody else pronounced in that way. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So very Colin. Anyway. But there are other areas affected, but it's having a significant effect on their defence squadrons. And then you've got a bloke called Dr. Mallory, who's working with a computer called Carl.
This is weird, isn't it? Because they sort of come out, you know, you think they're going to be central to the story, and they do crop up once more, but that's it. It's like, it's kind of like built up like this is a major thing, and they really aren't, are they?
No.
And the computer, oh man. I mean, this is classic 1980s. This is what a computer looks like, a whole cupboard.
It's a whole cupboard with a small screen, and yeah. The screen moves exactly in the same way as the Simpsons episode where Homer goes, "This is my voice."
Yes.
And the thing is, they call Dr. Mallory Dr. Mallory like he's a scientist. But later on, when he hasn't got the computer, he can't do a fucking thing. What are you a doctor in? Twattiness? I mean...
He's a doctor in switching the computer on, I think.
Right. Okay.
And he's assisted by Stella! Warden.
You just knows a wrong one.
Yeah, but another female baddie, which is good.
Yeah.
They're not afraid to make, you know, women baddies in this, which is... I like that.
Something. And they've discovered that the source of the biochemical agent, which is a poison, is a food disc. And they've managed to develop an agent that detects the poison and shows it. And it goes, it's like iodine, isn't it? It sort of goes blue.
Mm.
And they can return the pilots to a modicum of health. So they're not, people aren't necessarily dying. It's just that they're not fully functioning. They can't fly. So the really, really cringe-worthy Buck using football to teach the class just involves a fight with Duke.
It goes on forever, this bit.
Oh, it's fucking irritating and annoying. And then you have Tweaky and Theo, like, what's that noise? Because they hear a crash. There must be Buck. No, it's not Buck. No, yes, it is Buck. It's like, okay.
Had you noticed Theo's now got a slightly different voice?
I did. What went wrong?
They cast somebody else as his voice for the rest of the series, basically.
But I liked the first one.
Yeah, I think the first one was slightly better. But anyway, this one is played by Eric Serva, who had small roles in Battlestar Galactica and Deep Space Nine.
What was he in Deep Space Nine?
No, I shall have to check that now that you've asked me. That's you.
Sorry. Then Dr. Mallory has to leave the room and leaves Stella monitoring the computer, says, you know, if it has an antidote, it's got to be a factor higher than 3. But you just know she's going to bodge it up. And then this just cracks me up. It's like, how safe is this? Or everything's run by computer. You've got the computer council or whatever. You've heard in the pilot just how important computers are to this civilization.
Oh, Eric Server played Dipper in Battlestar Galactica. I guess that may have been his pilot name, is hoping anyway.
Wow.
Yeah.
And what was he in Deep Space Nine?
He was a peace officer. Peace out, man.
So yeah, you know how important computers are to this civilization, and there's nothing to stop Stella just opening up a panel or putting a bomb in and basically blowing the computer up. And all that happens is that he goes, "Alert! Alert! I'm in danger," in a kind of pathetic voice.
Danger, Will Robinson. Danger.
Yeah. And then he says, "I am in danger." Then he says, "Goodbye, Mallory," and blows up. It's like, okay.
Yeah, Eric Sevy was in The Circle as one of the, you know, the sort of Bajoran Civil War thing. Yeah. So, yeah.
He was a dodgy bloke.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
But not a big role, to say the least.
No. And then you have Wilmer and Buck, and they're sort of seemingly getting all sensual, and then she throws him because it turns out he's taught her judo. And then he walks really stiffly.
Yeah, it's quite good, actually. I like that.
Yeah. And then they get a call from Dr. Hewer on the fuck-off massive red chock-a-block computer.
Wow, yeah. It takes up half his wall. And it's a tiny screen.
It is such a tiny screen.
It's like, why does he need a big red cabinet for that?
But the thing is, I want you to put a picture on Facebook and the Tumblrs because it's got a little face on it.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah, it's
got a little face. Like, whoa. So Colin calls and says... I'm given to understand that Colonel Deering is here. And he says, "I'm not telling you what's gone on. Come now." Again, that horrible thing people do. "I can't tell you now. Just come." Anyway, she goes. And they start talking. And then Buck's asked to leave because he's not a member of the Earth Defence Defectorate.
Defectorate. That describes it nicely.
Sorry. I'm probably going to mangle this all the way through, and I am sorry. And apparently they have a fistula in common. Now, the actual planet is called Vistula.
Yes.
And that's the source of the problem, the supply of the food source. But to me, unfortunately, it sounded like fistula, which is a rather unfortunate skin growth around the anus.
Oh, that's nice. I was quite happy not knowing that. Thank you.
So, yeah, planet anus growth.
Mm-hmm.
It's where all they grow all their food.
Mm.
yum yum. Stella is flying off to Fistula. And then we get to see Jack Palance, whose delivery is like Shatner plus.
This is where the episode takes off, okay? You release Jack Palance and suddenly you've got something that's really worth watching. In a room,
man.
Yeah, preaching to a room of people dressed in togas.
Toga, 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 toga.
Wow. Yes, he's playing Carlisle.
Not Kal-El,
Carlisle. No, Carlisle. Also, of course, fantastic in Tango and Cash.
Yes.
Tango and Cash. 89 Batman, of course. Hawk the Slayer. Just a few of his career highs, if that's the right word. If there's scenery to be chewed, nobody does it with more relish than Palance.
Oh, I mean, you just want a bit of salad with that ham. I mean, the delivery is like Shatner, but worse, and with more volume, and done with hands making sort of clawed motions.
And he's got a cloak, which he makes the most of.
Oh, he does.
Oh, I mean, he played Dracula in a TV adaptation, and he still thinks he's playing Dracula, because he's doing the whole cloak thing, like, I'm a Batman.
Oh, Yeah, it really, really is something to behold. When you see this, either you're like, brilliant, love this, this is what I want, which is our reaction, or you're going to be like, no.
Run for the hills, yeah.
Yeah.
He is the United States version of Brian Blessed, I've decided.
He is. Yes. And I'm afraid I didn't really catch an awful lot of what he was saying because I was just mesmerised.
It's so hard to.
Isn't it? You're just mesmerised.
It's so bad, but it's a load of stuff about getting your vengeance on the people from Earth because the whole idea is that they're working hard to provide food for Earth for slaves.
Yeah.
And then it says that he's selling them as slaves or something and there's this whole colonial bod that we'll come on to, but yeah.
Yeah.
It's a bit confused, to be honest.
Yeah.
But hey, Jack Palance, everybody!
Yeah. Definitely. So then he's all sort of like, you know, the only thing you have to fear is, you know, he's from traitors and people who don't believe us. And then his hands glow red and this woman shops her husband.
Yeah, nice.
And he kills him with the red hand.
Oh, the Red Hand Gang, they were great.
And then you find out that from Stella that Dr. Hewer is about to be taken care of. And then you see someone pouring something onto something. And initially I thought he was pouring something into a ventilation shaft, but no, he's coating a boomerang.
Yes!
Because that's
what
necessary.
The hell is he doing? He's coating a boomerang with what, acid or something?
I don't know.
Because it's not good enough just to kill somebody with a boomerang. You've got to kill him with an acid-coated boomerang. How do you hold said acid-coated boomerang?
Yeah, what do you do
without melting
back?
Your gloves? And yeah, when you catch it, when he comes back, oh yeah, fire my hand!
Maybe that's why he keeps missing, because each time he's going to catch it,
he loses fingers.
Yeah. So what the fuck?
And it is, you know, as an assassin, they send Captain Boomerang. I mean, really?
And it's,
Is that really the best weapon for assassination? A blooming boomerang?
An acid boomerang.
An acid
Don't
boomerang.
Forget, it's an acid boomerang. Oh, fucking hell. And the thing is as well, this guy's all dressed up like he's a ninja, but he keeps cracking twigs so Bug hears him. And it happens like...
Bug.
Bug hears him. Yeah, that's how I've renamed him. But it happens like six times
Instead
or something.
Instead of the Mr. Pockets, let's face it. But yeah.
And so then he's like, you know, get down. And then...
He does his fighting crouch then. Moving from side to side on the screen in his fighting crouch. It just looks like he's crapped his pants.
He does!
Sorry.
And the thing is as well, it looks as though he's trying to creep along. So you expect creeping music. You know, that's what you get in the Pink Panther. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
No. All total fucking disco at this point.
Yeah.
Complete wagga wagga. Yeah. Oh, man. It's like somebody went, what's Buck doing? And someone went, he's being stealthy. And they went, play that fucking music, white boy. Play that fucking music, right. Play that fucking music, white boy. Lay down the boogie and play that funky music till you die. Yeah.
It happens later on in the episode as
well. Oh, it does.
This isn't the only occasion.
No.
Stealth Buck has
funky music.
Funky music every time.
Yes. Wow. Anyway, the ninja is a shit ninja with his acid boomerang and it gets stuck in a tree.
Mm.
Yeah. And then you end up in a situation where Buck and Wilma are then having a conversation, and that's when the whole promotion thing comes up, and it's like, she's like, that's not the only reason that the relationship ended. It's like, fine. And then you find out that Fistula is the basically planet Tofu. I hate that. It's the whole planet. She says, because they're going off to the planet to find out what's going on, and they're basically being sent as spies. They'll have a fighter escort, which includes Duke and Major somebody else whose name I forgot.
Major Fields, yes. It's very good to have a person of colour finally in this series that isn't playing a bad guy.
Yeah.
It's been a bit of a whitewash so far, let's face it. This is Sheila Wills, who was Lieutenant Deetra. Battlestar Galactica's Lost Planet of the Gods. Mm-hmm. You know, when they got all the female pilots. So.
Yes, yeah.
And I think she may have cropped up later on as well, but yeah. She doesn't have a huge role, sadly, but she's very good in it.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, it's fine. And Tweaky is a bit grouchy because he's been up all night and he's been making these special bracelets, which basically, A, will, and they will say if they've ingested poison, so they know, but also then enable each them to read each other's telemetry, so it kind of works like a tracker, which is, you know, logical. Yeah. You can see that if you're spreading on the spy mission, fair enough, so they've got their gadgets. But yeah, when they go off, it's like, just winds me up when people do this. Ice planet, desert planet. No, planets have variety of climate depending on how close or far you are from the poles and what the planet's axis is around its star.
Well, to be fair, this place has a desert as well as loads of acres of food, so it's not completely uniform, but yeah.
It's basically planet tofu, isn't it?
Yeah, just with a big desert.
Yeah, that's the bit they didn't cook properly, it's just all dry.
Mm.
And then you have Stella telling Khalil that Dr. Hugh has survived and that Buck and Wilma may be spies. And then you meet the governor who's fucking browned up.
This is Roddy McDowall as Governor Saroyan. He was most famously the original Caesar in Planet of the Apes. And he was also in Fright Night. And yeah, he does look... I mean, if you're being charitable, maybe he put too much fake tan on his face by accident.
I don't think that's the case. There's a
but
distinct...
he is wearing a turban.
Yeah. And his hands are a distinctly different colour to his face.
So and we know Roddy McDowall is a white guy, yeah. So...
Yeah, no, he's been browned up.
Ooh, uncomfortable.
Yeah, very.
And they're sitting around these weird tables with, like, greenery in the middle.
Oh, no.
So weird. It's like worst garden centre furniture ever, but there we go.
Yeah, it is a bit. And then initially, the Buck and Wilma are hesitant to eat because they know about the poison. And then it turns out that the governor uses his salary to bring food in from outside, at which point they start tucking in.
We're introduced to Julio, who's played by Don Marshall, who will be saying in our other podcast soon as Lieutenant Boma in the Galileo 7.
Okay. And you've also got the governor's son, who was the pilot, clearly sort of trying to talk some sense into his idiot father.
Mm.
And not getting anywhere. And then there's a serving girl.
This is Rhymer. Yeah. Bet she's never short of staples.
Oh.
It's a stationery. Well, it used to be. It may have gone bust by now, I should think. But anyway, it's a company that provides stationery in this country, Rhymer. Yeah. So this made me giggle all the way through.
Yes, but they clearly have a thing. And basically, you have... I can't remember now whether it's Buck or Wilma asks why there aren't any serving droids, or possibly even Duke.
It's Duke, yes.
Yeah. Because obviously where they are, you have people like Tweaky. And they're like, oh no, we have humans instead. And Buck's like, what, you've got slavery? And Wilma doesn't even know what slavery is. And so Buck explains and it's like, you know, this is wrong. And then the governor's son tries to explain, yeah, I've been telling you this for ages. But the governor is an idiot and Kal-El basically occasionally rounds people up and sells them.
Mm.
So he's nice then.
I don't quite know how's it. Who's he selling? He's selling them to the governor.
Yeah,
but they're still there doing the job. I do. So I think he's rounding up scavengers, nomads, or something.
Yeah,
I don't know. It's not ultimately very clear. But let's face it, they didn't lose any sleep over writing this. Let's not lose any sleep about trying to follow the plot.
No. And then you've got Buck in the bath.
Oh yeah! Oh, plenty of Buck in the bath. You see his hairy back at one point. You know, Shatner gets the ripped shirt scenes.
Yeah.
Buck gets the topless scenes. So far, we're 2 for 2 on this.
Yeah. So Rhymer comes in and she's supposed to be his for the night. Again. Ugh. Ugh, yeah. And she can see that someone's watching, so she puts some music on. And then at one point she said he's going to get up. He says, oh, I'm going to better get up before I get wrinkly.
Where? Oh, no.
Oh.
Buck's wrinkles. Oh.
Anyway, at this point, you would kind of expect that what she does is pass him a towel and turn
Look
her
away.
Back.
No, but she's
he just
not there.
He just stands up.
Yeah.
Now, we only get to see his back, but she gets to see everything.
She beholds the glory.
Oh, man. Just, yeah, no. And she describes Kal-El as a sorcerer. And he's like, really? And she's like, look, whatever.
Could be a mutant.
Could be a mutant. Murdered her brother, and he was working at one of the food plants, and she names which one it is. And so he's like, right, I'll go. And she's like, no, but if I'm seen leaving without you, it's going to be a problem. He's like, no, I'll go out the window. It's all right. Fine. So he goes to the plant.
Cue more funky music.
Yes.
And he's in his black ninja gear now as well.
Oh, which he got from fuck knows where. And so he fights with the workers and then he falls in.
Kicks them into bubble wrap. They're somehow unconscious. I mean, you know, if you're going to fall into something, fall into bubble wrap because it ain't going to hurt you.
But... No, but apparently it's the poison bubble wrap of wrong. It's the poison popping paper. And that's what it is. It's poison popping paper.
Yeah.
The poison is in the packaging. And he gets away, but Reimer is found out by... I keep wanting to call him Galileo. That's not his name.
No, it's Giulio.
Giulio.
Iglesias.
Yes. Ever and ever, forever and ever, you'll be the one that shines on me like the morning. Okay, are we playing out to that then?
No, we are not. Ooh, painful.
Yeah, she gets found out, but Wilma overhears, so then she goes to rescue her. But
she
I
like this. This is, you know, good stuff. A, she's snooping.
Yeah.
And then B, she gets her blaster, and she does a Bond line, nighttime is for sleeping, and zaps the guard. Yeah. Like, yeah, go Wilma. Unfortunately, then she's captured by Julio Iglesias, which is a bit of a letdown, but, you know, up till then, I was impressed with that.
And then they're put on a shuttle. They're going to be sent to the, what is it, the Stone Sea or something?
The Spice Mines of Kessel.
Yeah, effectively.
Mm. It's unfortunate that the shuttle they're put on is, to start with, is blatantly a Dala's shuttle from the pilot. And then later morphs into the shuttle from Battlestar Galactica. What the hell? It's just, use a consistent model for heaven's sake. Don't swap it halfway through. What did they stop off somewhere and then have to change shuttles because they haven't got a flat or something? What the hell happened there?
Oh, that one shuttle, it was a different route. It's like changing buses.
Yeah, that's it. They had to change from the 96 to the 422. What the hell?
Yeah.
Jeep.
Yep.
Oh, and when they take off, there's a big bay door that opens.
Yeah.
And again, it's just reused stuff from Battlestar Galactica. I think that was Gun on Ice Planet Zero that was from. It's like, what? That has no relevance. That's like based on an asteroid or something. Why are you showing us this?
It looks a bit Thunderbirds to me, to be honest.
Well, yeah, we remarked on that back when we covered Battlestar Galactica.
Fair enough. Anyway, Wilma tells Reimer not to give up. And then Buck finds Duke and says, you know, have you seen Wilma? And he's like, no, she left 2 hours ago. And he's like, we've got to rescue her, but I've also got to get this sample back. And he's like, right, give that to
Tainted bubble wrap.
Yeah, the poison popping paper. He's like, give that to Major Fields. She can take it back. We can rescue Wilma. That's logical. So then they go together following Wilma's tracker. But oh no, because fake German dude of wrong,
Galen, with his crap tash and crazy... I mean, his uniform has got different coloured gloves. It's got this. Okay, so the Khalil's guards barely wear anything. It's like S&M City, but they've got like this, I don't know, this bondage gear on. So he's wearing the bondage gear over red leather stuff because he thinks he's the Red Baron. And this is the appalling actor that's doing this naff fake cod German accent. Oh, it's painful to watch.
It's terrible. Really bad. And he's got a scar as well.
Oh, yes, because he's a baddie.
He has to have a scar.
Oh, yeah, anyone with a scar can't be trustworthy.
But yeah, his response is he's going to activate the power leech.
Not the power leech! Yes! Right, which involves turning a knob marked intensity. Which unfortunately I think controls
Jack Palance.
Jack Palance's performance. Yes. Turn it back down again. Turn it back down with too much intensity.
Oh man. So as a result of the power leech, they
power leech.
Oh god.
Like Chadich, but
power leech. As a result, they crash.
Yay! End of episode one, effectively. I think, as far as I can tell. Very hard to tell with the DVD, but that seems to be a natural break. Plus, it comes exactly halfway through the episode, so bit of a giveaway there. Now, Blessing Puri has given us feedback for both parts.
Oh, wow.
Because he was so impressed with this episode. And he went to the trouble of working out where the halfway mark is. So here we go.
Bless him! Go on then, what did Puri think?
What did Puri think of part one of this crap fest?
Oh, it's a really enjoyable crap fest, but it is a crap fest.
Hello, Orgs. Puri here to talk about Planet of the Slave Girls. Buck Roger episode called Planet of the Slave Girls. It's definitely not going to be anything dodgy in that or anything that looks bad nowadays, I'm sure. Now, a weird thing, on my DVD set, this actually puts this in as a feature-length episode, like it's a movie or something. I've roughly guessed where the cut-off point between parts 1 and 2 would be. And so I have put that in just at the point where Buck and the Major, who I don't like, crash land. It's one of the things, actually. It's called Planet of the Slave Girls. We see, like, a slave girl. I mean, we are aware there's more, and there's definitely girls on the planet who are slave, but really it's Planet of the Overacting Jack Palance. That's one of the things in this. This is a hell of a cast. You've got Roddy McDowell, you've got Jack Palance, and obviously Buster Crabbe, all lurking around in the cast. You do feel that they spared no expense, and that they were definitely trying to make this a fairly big budget series. And Jack Palance is doing his mad staring eyes and flapping his cloak around like a madman. He's overacting to hell and taking huge lumps out of the scenery with his ravenous jaws, but he's entertaining to watch. There are things like, I thought it took a long time to get going. They come through their hypergate and see the training flight being attacked, but apparently the Major, who we're supposed to think is kind of a rival for Buck, is just going to let the guy stew, basically. And they're kind of having disagreements, clearly, because they spend an interminable amount of time showing that these are two men thumping up against each other, because naturally they're going to become friends later. They kind of spend time tackling each other in a room for ages in a way that, to be honest, I don't think the sets were up to. I think they were at real risk of bursting through a wall at some point. I was a bit confused with Buck's status. Is he now part of the Earth Defence Directorate, or is he still just occasionally subbing in? That was a bit confusing. You lose a bit of a bit of respect for them when they set up a planet and it's who provides your food? Oh, slaves, obviously. What, you use slavery? Well, yes, but it's okay, they don't mind it. It's, what? Really? Those people are meant to be the baddies, so, Buck is right. And one of the things which I'll say, while we do see far, far, far too much Harry Gil Gerard and Gil Gerard, in the bath, it was when he stood up, it's like, no, stay in the bath. Stay in the bath, Buck. They do kind of make him come out. He's absolutely appalled by the slavery, because he is meant to be our heroic, heroiest hero of them all. And he's appalled by the slavery. And then later on, when the slave girl, off Project of the Planet of, is left in his room, and she's for him. He does his thing of, right, that's fine. There's not ever even a suggestion that he's off with her. He does his, I'll duck out the window to sneak around a factory. you know, even though it's clearly unconvincing because she's caught later. And yeah, I think that's the main problem, is that at the moment in this one, they do seem to be, well, Wilma's largely getting caught, captured, and then released, and there is kind of this chase, but we've not really seen much. You know, the plot seems to have taken a long time to get going, but I'll be back in a bit to talk about what I hope is part two, but until then, bye for now.
Bye.
Yeah, we did want Buck to stay in the bath.
Yes. Or at the very least have a strategically placed rubber ducky anyway. And I'm glad it's not just us that struggles with Gerard's name. Oh. You're going to do all these G's. But yes, he's kind of sort of... I'm not sure if he ever completely signs up. He certainly never gets a uniform anyway.
Although he does, doesn't he?
He did in the pilot, didn't he? But I don't think he... Did he? Right at the beginning of this episode, he was wearing a uniform. But then he got into his other gear. So yeah, it's a bit uncertain what Buck's status is, but yes. I don't ultimately think the writers care very much.
No. And yeah, I did worry as well that the sets weren't up to it for the for the American football thing.
When they crash into that very flimsy looking shelf unit,
yes.
You think, ooh, that's not long for this world, is it?
No.
But yes, it does take a little while to get off. Basically, for me, it was a bit of a snore fest until Jack Palance turned up. And then it was like, oh, I'm all in for this now. Give me more of this acting. And there is more of him in part two.
Oh, yes.
Right, Wilma tries out her kung fu moves on her guards and runs for it.
Which is good.
Yeah, well done, Wilma. Excellent stuff.
At this point, note what she's wearing.
Well, I can't remember if she's wearing the slave gear. I think it's after she slips her guard. She then somehow mysteriously next reappears in...
Slave gear.
Yeah.
She wasn't before. If she had been, it would have made sense, but
not
she wasn't.
Not consistent, but they were... Oh, and the sets for Khalil's base are pretty crappy, it has to be said. This is sort of Doctor Who standard at this point.
It is a bit, yeah.
Then Gil Gerard and Gro, who are, you know, in the middle of this desert wearing their Packamax, because that's their survival gear. Sweating bucket. You've got to feel for them. Sorry.
Gold lame Packamax.
Yeah, tinfoil suits, basically. Then they're pursued by humanoids in rags who make the noise of Geiger counters for some reason. Are they radioactive or something?
I don't know.
Cue fight with lots of flying kicks and stuff. Oh, dear. Tweaky and Theo repair Carl, the computer, because you've forgotten all about Carl, the computer, at this point, and they get started on an antidote. Hewer is worried about the lack of pilots, despite them having a defence shield in the pilot, but somehow they don't now or something, because they're vulnerable. Weird.
Oh, I don't know.
Anyway, this is the point where Wilma appears in her skimpy slave girl outfit, takes out another guard, so obviously she doesn't need Bucks, so that's all is well. Meanwhile, Reimer is left by the bulk of eternal stench.
Oh,
I mean, she's not thrown in.
No, you don't put them in there.
She's sort of gently placed by the side of it.
It's just like, what the fuck?
For ease of rescue, obviously, yeah.
Oh, man.
Duke complains about Buck's cooking skills. And then they're attacked by the ragmen who use exploding grenades. Yes.
What other kind of grenade is there other than the one that explodes?
Fair enough. But they're sort of slingshot. It's very odd.
Yes.
Anyway, too much fighting and male bonding, anyway. Wilma breaks into Khalil's control complex and tries to contact Earth using a keyboard that's in alphabetical order and looks really odd.
It does.
They clearly pulled a keyboard apart to then place... I mean, in some ways, I mean, obviously QWERTY dates back to the days of actual mechanical
keys.
Typewriters. So, you know, when you pressed a key, the little hammer went out. And, of course, if the keys used most often together were too close together, they jammed. So that's why we have the QWERTY keyboard. So in some ways it makes sense, but it just looks so weird.
Yes.
Anyway, Stella has foreseen the plan, though, and points a massive hand blaster at Wilma. I mean, that's a mighty weapon, that is.
Yep. It looks very dong-like, though.
Dong-like?
Dong-like.
Oh, God. Right. Hold on. Fine, if you say so. I mean, yes, clearly. Danton and Buck discover a load of starfighters. This is Khalil's fleet to attack Earth. I think they're called Scorpion fighters by the guys who made the models. I mean, this is a glass mat to begin yeah. with, I think. And obviously, so, you know, a mat of some sort anyway. We later see a model of one of them, and it's a really nice design. I mean, it's obviously a kit bash.
Yeah.
It's a load of sort of jet fighter parts put together. But I like it. It's good. They will crop up a lot, unfortunately, over the course of the series. Anyway, Duke steals one of the fighters to warn Earth, whilst Buck goes to save Wilma, of course. Stella! Spots Wilma's tracer thing and plans to use it to trap Buck, which is, you know, good thinking on her part. Danton argues with Hugh about making all the pilots available for Earth's defence. As Theo points out, what Duke is arguing for is rather sensible, really. Yeah, I mean, why is Hugh saying, oh no, let us leave ourselves defenceless? It's just bizarre. Tweaky burble swink, which Theo refuses to translate for Hugh, but turns out to be they're volunteering to be pilots. Right, how is he going to reach the controls, because presumably these things have got pedals. But anyway, Buck just wanders into the base, accompanied by his cool stealthy ninja theme, so that's how he got in, obviously.
It's a trap!
And Stella! And some guards surround him. It looks like he's going to kung fu kick his way out of the situation, but then runs into a force field and knocks himself out.
That's brilliant. It's amazing.
It's just boom! He's bowed,
but credit to the stuntman who did that, because the fall is dead convincing.
Yeah. Anyway. Hugh has assembled all available fighter pilots, including one Brigadier Gordon. Yay, Buster Crab, a.k.a.
And is it Gordon as in Flash? Is that deliberate?
Yes, exactly. Yes, because he played Flash Gordon as well as Buck Rogers. Tweaky reports for duty as well. Yeah.
But when he's good, you get this really awkward situation where Dr. Theo says, I must be rubbing off on you. And you're just like, ooh, not with him that shape. No. But he has this thing, he says, I've even reprogrammed myself to accept Duke as my superior. And I kind of like the sort of, you can tell that Theo doesn't like the fact that he's done that.
Yes.
How does a computer reprogram itself, though?
Apparently they do it all the time, so, you know.
Mm. Okay.
Buck is brought to Khalil, who orders his fighters to launch, and it turns out Galen was Earth's best military strategist. Cue more bad acting.
Oh, a lot of bad acting.
Buck and Wilma, who's now supporting a band around her head for some reason. Because she never had that before.
No.
Thrown into the bog of eternal stench as well. Apparently it's actually all about cooking them, as Rhymer is stationary due to the heat. Get it? Rhymer is stationary. Hey! As they hear people calling out Khalil's name, Buck refers to Howdy Doody.
What the?
Yeah, that's a very old United Statesian kids TV programme. Think Muffin the Mule, basically. Lots of puppets. Yeah.
Right.
Cue more scenery chewing from Palance as he inspires his people to take to their fighters. Except the guys who then run out to their fighters aren't the guys in togas.
No, they're the people in the S&M gear. Uniforms. Yeah. Bizarre.
Buck uses one of the Rag People's cherry bombs.
Cherry bomb!
Stuck under a helmet to propel himself into the air.
Because that's what you do. If you want to defuse a bomb, you just put a helmet on it
top.
And stand on it. You're fine.
Yeah, don't lose a single toe. All is well.
Yep.
He escapes through a convenient hole in the wall, coming back with a rope for the women to haul themselves out.
Oh, and it's just... I get that... The pipes, if they're going to go through a wall, have got to go through a hole. But the hole is fucking massive. Way more massive than it needs to be.
And the pipes don't go through the holes either.
No.
So,
It's just there is a hole, but there's no pipes actually going through it. It's just near them.
Anyway, you get a generous ogle at Wilma's knickers, if that's your thing. I mean, clearly I'm above noticing such things, but, you know. As Buck and Wilma steal the last two of Khalil's fighter ships, Rhymer Pritt sticks behind to lead an uprising. Get it? Pritt sticks behind. Sorry. And yes, apparently she's got loads of staple guns that she's stashed away to arm them all with. I'm not letting go of this pun, I'm sorry. We learn Wilma took out both the guards. She's such a cool character. Except you don't get to see a fight, that's the annoying thing. You get to see Buck do his crap moves.
Yeah.
But you never see Wilma fight. I mean, she's clearly awesome, but you don't get to see it. It's like you're not allowed to see a woman fight. Oh dear. Buck convinces Danton that it's him, thankfully. Otherwise, I guess he may have been open fired on him by answering an O.J. Simpson pop quiz.
Wow.
Strangely, the most famous thing about O.J. Simpson was that he played for the Buffalo Bills. Funny enough, in the 21st century, that's not what we're remembering O.J. Simpson for, but never mind.
Yeah.
They weren't to know. Buck points out that they just need to take out Galen, who is the enemy's star player. And yes, he gets to do his blooming American football move. Wow. But we do get a spaceship dogfight. So theoretically, I can't complain. Except I will, because they keep using shots of their hatchet fighters from the pilot.
Yeah, yeah.
So 1 minute it's the scorpion fighters, the next minute it's the hatchet fighters. Cheap! Stop them, you fools! Yeah. Galen yells. And Buck and Gordon get to share some nice dialogue about being from different times, which, yeah, it's kind of cool. Then Buck says they have some cleaning to do downstairs.
Oh.
No! Seeing the writing on the wall, Khalil tells Stella to prepare his personal cruiser. Reimer fills the few rebels in on his planned betrayal, and they stop their toga party to go and fight. Wow. Khalil finds himself surrounded. He does a big swish with his cloak.
He does. He does a twirl. He does a full 360 twirl.
And goes to use his hands of death on Buck, but apparently they only work on people who believe in him. Okay. Governor Saroyan quits, but is persuaded to listen to his son's advice in future, along with Reimer, which is nice. And then there's a killer final scene. Buck seemingly goes off with Wilmer and Duke for a threesome. It's just...
Oh, God.
Wow. And you do begin to... There's the S&M gear, there's Tweaky's freaking head, and there's all the innuendo here.
I mean, yeah.
They clearly were... This has got to be on purpose, isn't it?
He may as well be called Fuck Rogers.
Well, that was what I was going to suggest. But
I mean, Rogers for a start.
Yes. Yes, he does. Wow. I mean, it's not quite as cheesy as the title is going to suggest, but it is still pretty cheesy, isn't it?
Yeah.
And what is Khalil's plan? Oh, is he taking over the Earth? Vengeance on the Earth? It's not completely clear. Never mind. And, you know, how is he... Once he gets into Earth, he's got this bunch of guys in S&M gear. I don't know. It's just all very odd.
Yes, it's not really thought through, is it?
Add to that the fact that you've got these slapdash odds and ends effects from Galactica and the pilot.
Oh, yeah. And you can see that it's Galactica, can't you?
Yeah. And the series already seems cheap.
Yeah.
I mean, I'd ask why Jack Palance was slumming it in this, but clearly he hungered for more scenery to chew. So that's
Yeah.
Palance got to eat.
It's a bit like you might ask why Richard Briers was in that Doctor Who one.
Yes, it's an equivalent to Paradise Towers, yes.
Isn't it? Yeah.
And every Brian Blessed performance ever.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. But with Shatner's intonation, just it. It's the emphasis on all the wrong words.
Then we have a bunch of other guest actors who barely get to do much. I mean, it's a shame we don't see more of Buster Crabbe, for instance. He's barely in it, but there you go. On the upside, Wilmer is a much stronger character in this than she is in the pilot. Yeah. She kicks ass. All right, you don't get to see her kicking ass, but she kicks ass. And she almost seems like Buck's equal, which is good. I hope that lasts. I don't suppose it will, but yeah.
You do get to see her throw some guards, don't you, when she escapes the first time?
Yeah, you see her escape, but you don't actually see it hit anybody at any point.
No.
It cuts away whenever she commits an act of violence, which is a bit... Yeah, never mind. And Duke... He's a bit of a weird character because, I mean, initially you really hate him and he's involved in that big dick-off with Buck. But then he kind of becomes the likeable character and ends up in a threesome with Buck and Wilmer, so...
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what it's actually trying to say. I mean, perhaps it's saying something about cults and the cult of personality. But if so, it's not very high up in the mix, it has to be said.
No. But to be honest, though, unlike Star Trek, which had a message, I don't know that Buck Rogers is necessarily trying to say anything at all. I mean, if its aim is to entertain, it's done it, hasn't it? This was really entertaining.
Yes, possibly not in the way it was trying to, but yes, it was.
It was really entertaining.
It was a fun way to spend 90 minutes. You can't argue with that.
Yep.
I mean, it's at one point you get a message that slavery is bad. Okay.
Yep.
And the person who comments on it is Major Fields, who's our one black character. So that's a bit on the nose, really.
Because you've got the black baddie, haven't you, who I keep calling Galileo.
Oh, yes, you've got Julio Iglesias as well, who's barely in it, yes. Yeah. But he's number two to blacked up Roddy McDowall.
Well, browned up Roddy.
Browned up, but yeah.
Yeah, still wrong.
It's so wrong.
Very wrong.
Turbaned up as well. Oh, yeah. I mean... judging this by, you know, modern day standards probably isn't the best technique, I can't help feeling. But it's, I'm not even sure. I was about to say its heart's in the right place, but I'm not even sure that's true either. So
it's fun.
It is silly fun.
You can say it's fun. I enjoyed watching it. It wasn't good, but I enjoyed watching it.
And Jack Palance was worth the price of admission alone. Yeah. If you bought the DVD box set, you got your money's worth from Jack Palance's performance, didn't you?
Yes.
Let's face it, folks.
Yeah.
Or at least I hope you feel that. Let's find out what people thought.
And we've heard from Jeff, who writes, "The title of this episode brings to mind a sleazy, borderline pornographic pulp paperback. Fortunately, it did not live up to the title.
Well,
there
not
was
in that way.
Some gross stuff, like the Rhymer being given to Buck. Yeah. Also, what was going on with Roddy McDowell's character? The costume itself was bad, but it looked like he was wearing blackface.
Yep.
I've only seen him outside of an ape costume as Bookworm on the old Batman show, and he didn't look like that.
He didn't look like that in Creep. Was it Creep Show?
Yeah, but no, his skin is not naturally that brown.
No. And we can tell from the colour of his hands, for starters.
Yeah. Otherwise, this was a blast. They recycled the Plague Grounds All the Pilots plot from Battlestar Galactica, but at least they've already made the racial leap that women can fly spaceships.
Yes, that's
it's
true.
Almost like chicks are people too and can do everything that men can. I do hope my sarcasm was obvious. Jack Palance was awesome.
Oh, yes.
I can think of only one other actor who could portray a mad space cult leader as well. And Brian Blessed did that in Blake 7.
Yes. Cygnus Alpha.
Yes.
Ol made that point on the Facebook group as well. This is like Buck Rogers does Cygnus Alpha, basically.
Yeah. It was really fun having Buster Crabbe as the old veteran, even if they did lay it on pretty thick with some of the dialogue.
They did. And they could have used him more than they did, but no, apparently he's just there for laughs.
And that fight in the warehouse, I haven't laughed that hard in a long time.
Oh, no, don't kick me into the bubble wrap. That's really going to... Oh, wait, it doesn't hurt at all, but I'm unconscious.
I feel kind of bad about how much I'm enjoying this show, but it's just so much cheesy fun that I can let some of the uncomfortable aspects slide. It is cheesy fun. That is a good description.
We have some MP3 feedback from Doreen.
This is my feedback for Planet of the Slave Girls. The trainee at the beginning looked like he should be in Happy Days. Buck is a rubbish teacher, using all that jargon without explaining what the football terms mean. I love the dialogue. What was that? Sounds like Buck. It was classic. Food discs look boring. There is far more to eating than just sustenance. How did Buck know that the poison was in the packaging? Just by looking at it. Also, I thought the computer Carol was great, especially when he was arguing with Mallory. Rhymer was brilliant, a brilliant character. And the gold sunscreen suits were really bad. The black grenade thing Buck found after the scavenger attack looked like a perfume bottle, I thought. Dr. Theopolis is hilarious, and I really liked it when he told the commander that he'd programmed himself to take orders, even though it was really hard. And the ending was really quite funny. Buck Rogers, the gooseberry in the 25th century.
Yeah, I fear he's not going to be the gooseberry, but yes. Yeah, the bubble wrap, the Buck discovers the bubble wrap's the source of the poison because it's got a blue stain on it. That's your only giveaway from that. Yeah.
But it's...
And he's a rubbish teacher. Yeah, American football nonsense was just like, yeah, that's really going to work in the 21st century. Well done, genius.
Yes. And I think you're right. Food discs do look boring. There is more to eating than just sustenance. I mean, if they were rations, that would be different, like military rations, because they're small, they're compact, it would make sense. But the idea that's what everybody eats, it doesn't really work, does it?
Not really, no. But that's so many of these shows of the future, it's usually a pill, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, that's a whole meal, that is.
Yeah, no, it isn't.
Thank you, Doreen.
Thank you.
Next up, we have Sampo and Yonah. Let's see whether this has blown her mind as well.
Hello.
Hello. It's us again, and we just watched Planet of the Slave Girls.
start off by saying there were a lot less slave girls in that episode than we initially thought.
My expectations were like something like Leia in Jabba Hutt's nest, but there were nothing. What was it called? Planet of the Slave Girls, when there were also men as slaves.
There was only one slave girl with a speaking role, and I don't know.
The woman who...
Oh, yes, who ratted out his husband.
Mm-hmm.
That died by the
red
hands of death.
Yeah. And they had in the beginning, they had this great, amazing love boat theme. It was nice.
The credits, I mean, the love boat credits.
Indeed.
Well, I mean, it was a lot. Yeah, it was a lot better than in the one in the last episode. So I'm glad we don't have to look at the.
I hope this one stays.
I'm pretty sure it does. What else? They ask Buck Rogers to teach the people about tactics. I mean, would we ask someone who came from the 16th century to tell us something about military tactics?
Archimedes with the bronze mirrors and.
I think Archimedes was a bit, that was like 2,000 years ago or something. Well, we're going off topic, but but I mean, the classroom, he was explaining by using American football terms, and I mean, we couldn't understand what he was talking about either.
I was wondering, were we supposed to laugh when they started fighting?
I don't know, I mean, the music suggested that, but it was just awkward. I mean, after the sixth tackle
maybe
or something.
Maybe humor from the 70s.
Maybe. So, I mean, after the sixth tackle, maybe they should have sort of seen it coming or something. But I mean, I'm glad that I can't remember the guy's name, but I'm glad that Buck Rogers and the guy, they bonded over sharing stories about O.J. Simpson out of all people. Okay, I just remember something. The guy with the magic boomerang, we never found out who that was. That was just some random guy, I guess.
Oh, yeah. Maybe it's something that comes along every episode.
Oh, it's like Kato from Pink Panther.
Yes. I noticed a lot of design furniture in that episode.
Yes, you would notice something like that, but yeah.
And maybe they were cheaper back in 70s, but today one of the Eero Aarnio's pastel chair, I noticed a few of them, is almost 2,000 euros per each, and this Fritz Hansen's egg chair would cost 8,800.
I'll take your word for it, and maybe they just thought they looked futuristic or something.
That's exactly why they chose modernist furniture in Skiffy movies and series. But it's lovely to spot those things.
Yes, you might be able to figure out which of one is student of art history. So, well, nice that this series offers you some material, I guess.
This is nice.
Yes, the bad guy, I mean, I can't remember anyone's name. What was the bad guy's
Stella.
Name?
Stella.
No, not Stella, the man.
Okay. Stella's man.
Yeah, but with the glowing hands.
Khalil.
Khalil, yeah, that's it. I mean, I don't know, there was just something off about. I mean, he always seemed to react too late or too much to things. And his plan sucked. Okay, first of all, he said that he had a fleet of 100 fighters, but what we saw on screen didn't really correlate. It was like reality versus expectations. I mean...
This is exactly the episode with reality versus expectations.
Yeah, I know it's budget, but I mean, they're talking about having 100 fighters and they couldn't even put 100 triangles on the screen. Yeah, like...
The triangles are cute, I think.
Yeah.
How they mingled when the battle was going on.
Yes, poor triangles.
I was thinking also if whether they were vegetarians.
I think they were growing soy. Or something, so
yeah.
I guess they were.
And when they were catching something to eat from the ground, Mr. Bucket's new best friend said that it's pretty hard eating something just crawled on the ground. I prefer my wood bills.
Mm. So maybe
they don't eat meat in the 25th century, which is yay.
I didn't actually think of it like that, but makes sense, I guess. What else? The doctor who was, we suppose he made a cure We never saw it, but we can assume so. It was actually pretty touching how much he cared for his robot partner. So, I mean,
well, I think it was nice. They really bonded better than those two odd robots with BDBD thing and
yes, and they said stuff like, "You can really rob me off," or. this episode, instead of the females being scantily clad, the men were actually dressed in leather straps, which was, I guess, refreshing. I mean, compared to the last episode, this was...
Maybe they were their suspenders.
Yes, I mean, this was almost woke compared to the last episode. There was a lot less groaning about the treatment of women in this episode than the last one, which was almost surprising.
Yeah, the title tried to lead us think about this conventional slave woman, but I didn't see any, and I think I was a little disappointed.
And you only had the guards in the leather straps to look at, who really weren't that enthusiastic. The moment the revolution or whatever began, they just sort of wandered off.
Yeah, that's when you use slaves.
Yeah. And just to wrap it all off, in the end, Buck and Wilma and the one guy, they just go off to her threesome, I guess.
Oh, that was... Well, that's what it was.
Well, that's what I thought.
Okay, it's way better than mine. Let's stick with that one.
Okay, I think that's a good place to end this feedback.
Yeah.
Did you have anything else?
No, I'm fine.
Okay, well, bye.
We really need some nice closer.
We'll work on that.
Yeah.
Toodaloo.
Toodaloo.
Yeah, I'm glad it wasn't just me who thought it ended on a threesome, because
yeah.
That was just the way you couldn't help read it, really.
No.
And who would think that the Buck Rogers episode Planet of the Slave Girls would turn out to be the woke episode? But you're right, the men are scantily clad compared to the women, so that's definitely a plus.
Yeah.
Plenty of pecs on show here.
Definitely. And I love the description of Jack Palance. He always reacts either too late or too much.
Just mostly too much, it has to be said.
Yeah. Yeah.
And apparently it's Kato with the boomerang, so...
No, Kato, you fool! This is not the time!
No.
Pink Panther. Oh, wow.
Yeah, and yet they should have seen it coming after the sixth. The tackles.
Yeah. That was way too prolonged, that scene. It was just painful.
Yeah, and it was just awkward.
Yeah.
And no, we wouldn't ask someone from the 16th century for advice about tactics now. So it doesn't make sense that they're going to ask... Well, the only reason it makes sense is that everything is done by computer, and Buck in the pilot episode has shown the error of that.
Mm.
It makes it all too particular.
Yes, but there's no reason for using loads of bloody American football bloody
metaphors. That was all just bollocks. It was, yes. What did Drew and Tracy make of this?
Hello, so we've just watched Buck Rogers' Planet of the Slave Girls.
We did.
And what did we think of that one then?
Not as good as the first one.
Well, it didn't make me laugh as much as the first one, but I do think this was very entertaining. There was a lot going on. I quite enjoyed it.
Yeah, it's okay. It's all right.
Go through some points then.
Okay.
First of all, I liked the funky music.
The music was great,
when
he was sneaking around the factory.
Funky music. Loved it.
Great music. The assassin, you know, the guy with the boomerang. He was stepping on every twig, wasn't he? Or did he just have like cornflakes in his boots?
But as I said to you at the time, I was like, so an assassin goes into like jungle, the woods, whatever.
Yeah, I don't know. It's a garden, isn't it?
But has got glowing studs his whole black uniform.
And still Buck couldn't see him, could he?
That's not quite right there. And what was Buck doing? He was like crouching down low.
I don't know.
Dear me. The fight scene in the warehouse, 347.
Yeah,
that was hysterical. You could clearly see that was not Gil Gerard there.
No, it was loads. Every time they have a fight, you can see. You're not meant to watch it on a HDMI.
You're not, but...
Like 50-inch TVs and Blu-rays. Yeah, but there are
sometimes when you're
whatever.
Like, oh, is it them? But you could clearly see, like, the face. And it was quite clearly someone who was about 10 years younger.
Yep.
That was a bit daft.
The baddies. Just the campest bunch ever, wasn't it? I mean,
the centurion uniform.
The henchmen are look like Leatherman from YMCA. The second in command, Galen, had the John Inmans about him.
Yeah, he did. But I loved Khalil. He had like about 20 stripes down his like arm.
So he's decorated birdie ever,
isn't
he?
But then his helmet as well had to have all the stars on there as well. Yeah. That's just a bit of vanity going on there, isn't
Khalil,
it?
Khalil, Jack Palance, just like
biggest
over the top
ever.
Yes,
that
obviously
was just making me laugh.
And every time he's just explaining the plot, isn't he? Just he's just that typical like Mike Myers, Austin Powers birdie. Yeah. Must explain everything. Although one thing I would say, he obviously was one of the baddest baddies you've ever seen.
Was
because
that?
Wouldn't you put the prisoners in the cesspit room? The bog of eternal stench. That's where you put your prisoners, isn't it?
No, but you don't know it's the bog of eternal stench. You just thought it was like a heat room.
Oh, I'm
like
sorry.
A mad room. If
that's where all the turds go for the whole complex.
Why didn't they like die of like stink then?
That's why they wanted to get out of there so quickly.
I don't think so. I think you're being a bit like over kind of arching on that
what
one.
What was that room then?
Well, it was just like a bog room. Was not bog in like toilet. Bog room as in like hot mud. No, I think the girls were
the hot mud room.
Yeah, I think the girls are quite liking it. They're getting a bit of a facial going on there.
Yep.
Anywho, but we have to say, talking about that, so for Buck to kind of escape and kind of find an escape, he had to climb across that like that pipe, slip in and slide in, then he had to like project himself over the
putting the grenade
bomb
in the helmet,
exactly.
Stand on the helmet.
But yet when he wanted
I've seen
the girls...
some YouTube videos like that, they never go that well.
But then when he wanted the girls to come across, they literally just stepped across something.
I know,
something. What the fuck was that about?
Yep.
But we left the gold outfits in the desert.
Yeah.
What the fuck was that about?
That is strange, isn't it?
I find myself saying quite a lot. I listened to the feedback last time and I was like, continually, what the fuck? But dear me, what was that?
Don't wrap
yourself in tinfoil if you're going through
in
like
the
a desert.
No.
That's not what you want to do. But poisoning the earth,
yep,
so it can be conquered easily, that's quite genius.
Yeah, I guess so. Poison all the pilots so they didn't have defence. I guess so. Yeah. Not a bad plan, not a bad.
And there's nothing like a good space battle at the end.
That kind
of brought it home, didn't it? Like, that was like, good, Buck Rogers, you know, let's have
fighting. Well, I was a bit cheesy, so they use the exact plan that he'd
been
teaching.
Well, of course, but
this
is like Glenn A. Larson, and it's like 70s, and it's like... space battle to win the day.
Yep. Talking of which, though, Buck Rogers does talk a load of rubbish, doesn't he? He's meant to be like a man out of time, but even for like the year 2021, he's just talking nonsense, isn't he? There's a turkey on your back and all this rubbish. It's just like, what are you talking about?
Yeah.
But yeah, not bad. Not as good as the first one. Not bad.
Not as funny as the first one.
No, it wasn't.
But
no.
I did enjoy this again.
It's all right.
I liked it.
Yep.
Should we leave it there?
Okie dokie.
Take it easy, guys. See you later. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. I found this funnier than the first one, but mainly because of Jack Palance, to be honest.
Yeah, me too.
Plus that ending with the threesome. Wow.
Yeah. and you're right. What the fuck with the gold outfits? Don't wear tinfoil in the desert.
I mean, clearly they're sweating bucket. You've got to feel for those actors. It's terrible.
Oh, man. Yeah. And it is the bog of internal stench.
It is. I'm glad it wasn't just me that went there. Yep.
Also, like, if you want to kill people, put them in the bog, not in the room near it. It's like, what the fuck is that about?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
And finally, what did Puri make of the second half?
Hello again. Puri here to talk about Planet of the Slave Girls Part 2. Now, I might be putting in a bit of a product description here because... While my initial worries were that it was going to be it was going to be something slightly problematic with slave girls and skimpy outfits and whatnot, you know what we all expected for Buck Rogers doing Planet of the Slave Girls. On the other hand, I'd kind of like to complain because I was promised a Planet of the Slave Girls, and what I've got is some manky corridors and... Buck and the other general wandering around the desert, dressed like a kind of baked turkey on a gold bomber jacket and that rain hat that your gran has. Just them plodding through the desert. I know it's kind of meant to be them bonding, because yes, they've gone from people who will just attack each other and hate each other's guts to the best of friends by the time they've got to go and rescue everything, and you know, just about slapping each other in the arse as they go. You know, Buck, you're my kind of guy, slapping his arse and that sort of thing. But the actual bit when they're actually in the mountain, when they're in Jack Plant's zone and overacting, they do seem to just be basically being stuck into that hot room, which is apparently a death penalty, and just basically captured and released, captured and released. I didn't actually mention Jack Plant's sort of sidekick, the sort of onesie wearing lady. Quite liked her, even though, yes, she was always doing things for the evils. Now, the other thing in this, I think, was it this episode where Buck sends a sample with... that was one of the things. I quite liked that we saw another major, and it's a woman of colour. I did like that. And that she's sent back with the sample of the poison. But the problem is that the scientist they have is blimmin' useless. Because he's just saying, oh yes, even with a sample, though I can't do anything without his sarcastic computer. I forgot to mention the sarcastic computer in the last part. Does he know how to do his job? Or actually, does the computer do everything and he just presses the buttons? Where are they trying to make a point with that? Now, obviously, it all culminates in a big firefight. Note to the Buck Rogers people, if you're going to have a big spaceship fight and you've made a new spaceship model, which I'm happy with, we've got new ships, but don't reuse bits of the firefight from the last episode, because every so often a hatchet fighter turned up. That was a bit distracting. Yeah, but I did like the idea that, yes, they're short in pilots, although I'm kind of annoying that the sacking the quarterback, yes, that is a proper American football term, had turned out to be the key to the battle, because every other ship was piloted by henchmen. But I did like the way they were kind of pulling, that they were basically low on pilots, so they pulled everyone out of there, so that's why you'd Tweaky flying fighter. I don't know why, my wife was confused about why Tweaky was wearing a helmet. What with his head being made of metal, and I think it's maybe just for the bigger modern tellies. I could definitely see the actor in Tweaky through the grills. I think that's where we've got Buster Crabbe, and I liked the initial, I've been doing this since before you were born thing. I thought, oh, that's quite a nice touch, but they did kind of labour it a bit, it's later. I did this in another time. I've been doing this since you were born. I was like, yes, we know he's from the old times. That's fine. Was he the old Flash Gordon, or was he the old Buck Rogers, or was he both? I could Google this. I did quite like it, the Brigadier Gordon, though. And it was quite a nice touch, but yeah. Ultimately, I think my gripe with this is I think this would have been a good episode, but as a two-part, it feels hellishly padded. I think that's where it kind of falls down a bit, but yeah. It's definitely cheesy, and it's definitely got some entertainment value. I still had fun with it, I think. Not for any quality things, but it's a fun thing to chat along to and point out the weirdness of. So all that remains for me to say is do keep up the good work. I always look forward to the podcast, and I'll be back to talk about the next couple of episodes. But until then, bye for now.
Bye, sir. Thank you.
Bye. Yeah. Yes, someone else who noticed how useless Dr. Mallory is. Doctor of what? Pushing buttons? What the fuck?
The doctor turning his computer on. That's he's all the doctor off, yes. Why is Tweaky wearing a helmet? Good point.
Yes.
That makes no sense.
No, he doesn't. Doesn't at all.
And yes, the reuse of footage from the pilot when it's not even the same spaceships. Oh, so unbelievably cheap.
Yep.
And they are manky corridors as well. You're quite right. Yep. Well, where do we go from here? Well, the answer is, interestingly, because the episode after the next episode is a two-parter. Next time, we shall be covering but a single episode, because, to be honest, that's all I think we can cope with at the moment. And we do have a busy week as well that week, so actually it works out quite nicely. But yes, what's the title? Hang on. Oh, God. Hell yes. Vegas in space.
Wow.
Be prepared for a very wide-collared Buck Rogers. That's all I'm saying for this one.
Wow. Okay.
But yes, we're recording that on Thursday in 2 weeks' time, whenever that is. The Thursday, the 13th of May, we shall indeed be covering Vegas in space.
Wow.
But just that episode, okay? And it's a normal-length episode, so we can all relax and chill.
And then the next one after that is a two-parter.
And then we've got another two-parter after that. Oh, my life! But, yes. Catch you next time. Cheery bye.
Bye-bye! Hey, yeah. Hey, hey. Hey, I once I was voiceover for Borg Rogers was provided by Michael David Sims from Earth2.net.
The Buck Rogers theme was played by Drew Barker.
All other music is used for illustrative purposes only, and no copyright infringement is intended.
The artwork for this podcast was created by Andy Palastides.
To contact us, send emails or MP3s to borgcast@gmail.com.
Contact us via Twitter at rev_org or borgcastammo. Hashtag borgcast.
Visit our website at galactica.libsyn.com.
Or view images relating to our cast on our Tumblr site, borgcast.tumblr.com.
You can join our Facebook page. There's also a Spotify playlist with all our playout tunes on it.
Shut it down!
What did I just see?